Praise the Lord. I welcome every one of you here tonight in Jesus' name. I pray that the word of God will have great impact in every life tonight. Open our eyes to see, our minds to perceive, our hearts to understand, and the will to go forth and be obedient. The Lord grant to everyone in Jesus' name. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for this hour. Thank you for this time. Thank you for your word. We're asking, Lord, that tonight you open the pages of the scriptures to everyone. And we're asking, Lord, that you enlighten your people, energize your people, encourage your people, and help us, Lord, to move forth in the strength of the Lord, in the power of the Lord, to be and to do what you have ordained for us to be and to do. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Welcome to Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm reading from verses 1 through to 4. Hebrews chapter 12, I'm reading from verse 1 all through to verse 4. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such great, such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. As we look at those verses tonight, you look at what it says in verse 1. It says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, talking about the witnesses, and saying we're compassed about with them, was such a great cloud of witnesses. It's referring to Hebrews chapter 11. Those worthies of old, those heroes of faith that were learned about in chapter 11. It says they formed like a cloud of witnesses in Ezekiel chapter 38. Reading from verse 9, Ezekiel chapter 38, and reading from verse 9, he refers to some people, many people actually, as a cloud. It says, thou shalt ascend and come like a storm. Thou shalt be like a cloud to cover the land. Thou and all thy bands, and many people with thee. There we have the authority to refer to the cloud that we read about in Hebrews chapter 12 as people, because it talks about all the bands, and it talks about many people, and it refers to them that there'll be the cloud covering the land. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 11, as it refers to these heroes of faith, and it refers to them as the cloud of witnesses. Hebrews chapter 11, reading from verse 2. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Those are the people he's referring to as the cloud. In verse 4, he says, by faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, In verse 5, he talks about Enoch. And he says, by faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death. The testimony about him is that he pleased God and he walked with God. Verse 7 is talking about Noah. And by faith, Noah, being warned of God, of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, and prepared an ark, built an ark for the saving salvation of his house. Come to verse 8, by faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into the place which he should after receive for an inheritance, he obeyed, and he went out, not knowing whither he went. Verse 17 talks about Abraham in another perspective. By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son. Verse 22 talks about Joseph. By faith, Joseph, when he died, made mention of the departing of the children of Israel, and he gave commandment concerning his bones. Verse 24, talking about Moses. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith they forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Verse 30, by faith the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. Verse 32, and what shall I more say? For the time will fail me to tell of Gideon, and of Barak, and of Samson, and of Jephthah, and of David also, and of Samuel, and of the prophets. Verse 33, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions. Verse 34, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Then verse 39, all these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise, God having provided some better thing for us, that without us it should not be made perfect. I've read those verses to you for you to understand that as we come to Hebrews chapter 12, we're referring back to chapter 11 as a great cloud of witnesses. These were people that by their faith encourage us, by their faith they enlighten us, by their faith they beckon on us and they tell us to come along, because whatever we might be going through, they've gone through something similar, they've gone through something greater, and they've gone through something more challenging, and they say by their faith that we too, we can walk with God. They say by their faith, we too, we can be obedient unto the Lord. These witnesses are still speaking to us today. We're told in chapter 12 of Hebrews, reading from verse 24. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 24, unto Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. He's telling us that Abel is still speaking to us today. And if Abel is still speaking to us today, Abraham is still speaking to us today, and Noah is still speaking to us today, and all those worthies of old and the heavy heroes of faith we've read about, they're still speaking to us today. Look at chapter 11 verse 4. It says in chapter 11 verse 4, by faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it, listen to this, by it he being dead yet speaketh. If Abel is still yet speaking today, that means that all the other people too, we find in Hebrews chapter 11, they're still speaking to us today. By their walk of faith, they're speaking to us. By the obedience of faith, they're still speaking to us. By the life of faith, they're still speaking to us. By their labor of faith, they're still speaking to us. By their consecration of faith, they're still speaking to us. By the step of faith, every step they moved, they're still speaking to us today. By their ministry of faith, they're still speaking to us. By their exploits of faith, they're still speaking to us. And because they're still speaking to us, it says, wherefore, we then that are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, this is what we should do now. Like those other people, they laid aside everything and they served the Lord, and they ministered to their generation, and they were obedient to the Lord. We will lay aside everything and then we serve the Lord, we run the race. Come back to Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm reading from verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, look at this, let us lay aside. It's saying we're running a race. And if we're going to run the race successfully, if we're going to run the race triumphantly, if we're going to run the race, and we're going to be like the people in Hebrews chapter 11, we lay aside every weight, and we lay aside the sin that so easily beset us. He says, let us run with patience. That word is for perseverance, actually, with perseverance, the race that is set before us. In running the race set before you, see these examples. It says, look at these witnesses, read of them, think of them, identify with them, stand where they stood, and then persevere and endure like they did, and run by their side. Think of their problems, and think of their challenges, and think of the things they went through, and stand side by side with them, and put your feet where their feet were, and put yourself where they were, and say that if I were confronted with what Abraham was confronted with, or what Noah was confronted with, or what Joseph was confronted with, what would I have done? How would I have reacted if I were there at the time of Joshua, and I was to live the life that Joshua lived? If I was to fight all those battles that Joshua fought, how would I have fought if I were there at the time of David, and I were to run like David ran? How would I have run if I were there in time of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and in the time of Daniel, how they stopped the lion's mouth, and how they quenched the violence of fire? What would I have done? That's why he's telling us, look at them, think of them, identify with them, stand where they stood, persevere like they persevered, endure like they endured, and walk like them, running by their side. Bear your own burden today. Tonight we're looking at these verses. I'm talking to you on running the race to win the ultimate prize. Running the race to win the ultimate prize. We're running in a race, and it is so that we can win the prize. I pray you'll win the prize. Are you there? I said you'll win the prize. Okay, if you don't want to win, I will win my prize. We'll win the prize in Jesus' name. Running the race to win the ultimate prize. Running the race. The reason why we're on is because we know we can win. And it's because we know the Lord by our side is strength for us, is grace for us, is power abiding in us, and the Spirit of God motivating us, and the Spirit of God energizing us, empowering us. We can, because it says we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. He's called us to run the race. He has appointed us to run the race. He has chosen us to run the race. And he's not going to abandon us by the wayside. He's going to be with us. He said, I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you. And so we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man shall do unto me. This race we're going to run. And we're going to run triumphantly. And we're going to run victoriously. And we're going to run until the finishing line in Jesus' name. Running the race to win the ultimate prize. Three things we're looking at. Number one, living all for Jesus while running with patience. Living all, there are things you need to leave behind. There are things you need to unload, and there are things you ought to offload. There are things you need to lay aside. There are things you need to put aside. Living all for Jesus while running with patience. Number two, looking unto Jesus until we receive the prize. There's no point starting and not finishing. There's no point beginning the race and not getting to the finishing line, because it's at the finishing line we get the reward. At the finishing line we get the prize. At the finishing line we get the commendation. It's at the finishing line we get the well done from the Lord. And we're going to run to the finishing line. And we're going to run well, and we're going to finish well in Jesus' name. Looking unto Jesus until we receive the prize. Number three, learning of Jesus in order to reach the peak. Learning of Jesus in order to reach the peak. Once we begin climbing, we're not going to stop until we get to the highest point. Until we get to the climax, until we get to that place that the Lord himself has destined that we're going to be. And that is the very highest point. You're not going to remain where you are now forever. Even tonight, you're not going to remain at the same point you came in Jesus' name. Because we're going to learn something of Jesus. And as we learn of Jesus, it's going to strengthen us, it's going to lift us up, it's going to energize us until we reach the peak. I'm getting there, you are getting there, we're going to get there together in Jesus' name. Learning of Jesus in order to reach the peak. Point number one, living all for Jesus while running with patience. Let's come back to Hebrews chapter 12. And let's read here from verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about, are surrounded with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight, and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. First of all, it tells us that we're running in a race. And this race is for everyone. every child of God, every believer. It tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 24. It says, "Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that she may obtain." It says, don't you know? Have you not seen them on the athletic field? Have you not seen those athletes, the way they run and the way they fight and the things they do, so that they can have the prize? It says, so run. It's directing that to you now as a believer, directing that to you as a minister. And it says, so run that she may obtain. And he says, and every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate, is self-controlled in all things. Now did do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. That's what you are going to have, incorruptible crown. I said that's what you are going to have. It says, I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one beating the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. It wasn't a castaway. Eventually, you will not be a castaway. It says we should so run, so that will receive the prize. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from verses 3 and 4. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Reading from verse 3. It says, "Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." You see what he's saying there? He's saying he has called us to be soldiers. And as soldiers, there's something to do on the battlefield. And on the battlefield, you cannot afford to be weak. You cannot afford to be like jellyfish. You cannot afford to be weak in your mind, even weak in your physical body. You have to be a good soldier of Jesus Christ. And in verse 4, it says, "No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who has chosen him to be a soldier." Again, it's emphasizing the fact that we're running in a race. And as we're running in a race, we run with perseverance. We run with patience, and we lay everything aside. He tells us about himself in Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3, here reading from verse 7. It says, "But what things were gained to me," already has told us to lay something aside. He is not telling us about his own example. He said, "I've seen the example of those heroes of faith in Hebrews chapter 11. And they had to lay something aside. They had to separate from something. They had to come out from somewhere so that they could do the will of God and run their own race." He said, "Me too, I've realized that." And he says, "What things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and I do count them but dung, that I may win Christ." And it says, "And be found in him," verse 9, "not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith." It says, "that I might know him, that I may know him, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings." And it says, "be made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained either, were already perfect, but I follow after, I pursue, I move on, I'm persevering, I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do every day. This one thing I do. Every challenge, this one thing I do. At every crossroad, this one thing I do. At every opportunity, this one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He says, that's my goal, that's my dream, that's the ideal, that's the destination, that's what I'm running after, to get to that prize and to win that ultimate prize eventually. Now we're coming back to Hebrews chapter 12. And in verse 1, Hebrews chapter 12, I'm reading here from verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. The race that is set before us. You need to think about that. The race that is set before us. Already we've read about Abel, about Enoch. Would you know there was a difference between Abel and Enoch? We've read about Noah. We've read about Abraham. Would you know there's a difference between Abraham and Noah? And we've read about Joseph and about Moses. There's a difference, a major difference between Moses and Joseph. We've read about Joshua and about David and about Daniel. And there's a major difference between any of those people that you compare together. In the case of Noah, he was to build an ark. Just him, given that assignment, and that was the race it was to run. It was to do that for a number of years under the shame, reproach, and the jesting of the people, because they had not seen any rain. But it was to persevere, and every day it was to keep on building that ark. In the case of Abraham, he wasn't to build an ark. The race that was set before him is to leave his home country, and then without knowing where he was going. And if anybody asked him, Abraham, where are you going? He says, I don't know. The only thing I know, God has called me to come out. He has not told me where I will get to. That was his own race that was to run. Eventually, he set in the land of Canaan. And then God called him and said, Abraham. It's now Abraham. He's moved from being Abraham to Abraham. He said, here am I. Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and sacrifice him to me in the mount I will show you. And that was his own, his race, his own. That was not told Noah. That was not told Enoch. But Abraham alone. You see, the race you are running is peculiar to you, and the race I'm running is peculiar to me. There is no comparison and there is no competition. And now we come to Joseph. Here is Joseph now, and the Lord showed him a dream, and he saw all those brothers of his. And God said, this is what you will do. You know his story. He went to Egypt, and then he was in the prison. He was the only one that had such a race to run. We're compassed about with such a great cloud of witnesses, and they're different one from the other. Here is Moses now. I've seen the affliction of my people. Come, and I'm going to send you to them, and you're going to bring them out of the land of Egypt. Again, that was peculiar to Moses, and he couldn't say, okay, now I'm going to see somebody that did this before me, and I'm going to learn something from what they did. No, it was peculiar to Moses. That was a peculiar race, and he had the peculiar grace of God to carry that through. And then as you go from person to person, you will see that God set them, he actually set the race before them, and he set them for the race. You remember what we have read in verse 1? It says that you run the race which is set before you. I want you to underline that word set. Set is peculiar. I'm coming to Genesis chapter 41, verse 41. Genesis chapter 41, and I'm reading from verse 41. Here is what is telling us about the race. The Lord set them to do that, and the Lord set the race before them. In Genesis chapter 41, reading from verse 41, and Pharaoh said unto Joseph, see, I have set thee. It's God that did it, but he used the Pharaoh. I have set thee over all the land of Egypt. I want you to come to 2 Samuel chapter 7. 2 Samuel chapter 7, and I'm reading from verse 12. 2 Samuel chapter 7, reading from verse 12. And when thy days are fulfilled, this is God talking to David, and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee. You see that word set? I will set thy seed after thee, which shall proceed out of thy bowels, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build an house for my name. That was set for Solomon. It wasn't set for David. David wanted to do that, and God said, no, you will not do that. That's not the race that is set for you. I'm going to set up your son, and that race will be for Solomon, your son. I'm looking at Jeremiah chapter 1. In Jeremiah chapter 1, and I'm reading here from verse 10. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 10. See, I have this day set thee over the nations. You see that word said? That's for Jeremiah. Here is what I've called you for. Here is why you were born. I set this race before you, only you. And you cannot say, okay, but why me? This was not given to Moses. He had his own set ministry. And this was not given to Joshua. He had his own set ministry. See, Jeremiah, I have this day set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pull down and to destroy and to throw down and to build and to plant. I pray that what God has said before you, you will not fail. You will not be blind to see. You will not be comparing with other people. You will not say, but why is my task so difficult like this? That's what he said before you. And the grace of God will carry you through. The strength of God will carry you through. Give me a good, good amen and confirm it. We're looking at Ezekiel chapter 33. Ezekiel chapter 33. And I'm reading from verse 7. So thou, O son of man, I have set thee. As it have set thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. In the case of Jeremiah, I set thee over the nations. In the case of Ezekiel, just the nation of Israel, just the land of Israel. Therefore thou shalt hear the word at my mouth and warn them from me. When I say unto the wicked, O wicked man, thou shalt surely die, if thou dost not speak to warn the wicked from his way, that the wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at thy hand. Nevertheless, if thou warn the wicked of his way to turn from it, if he do not turn from his way, he shall die in his iniquity, but thou hast delivered thy soul. You can tell here what God was saying. He said, I set thee He said, all these people, as you come to the New Testament, you find in Acts of the Apostles chapter 13. Acts of the Apostles chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 47. Acts chapter 13, verse 47. For so as the Lord commanded us, saying, I have set thee to be a light to the Gentiles, that thou shouldest be for the salvation unto the ends of the earth. You see, the New Testament here, God, the Lord himself, talking to Paul the apostle, and talking to Barnabas, talking to that team, I have set thee. He's the one that does the setting, and he puts the race before you. And then you have to walk in that way. You have to run that race. You're not looking to the left. You're not looking to the right. You're not asking like Peter asked, what will this man do? What will that sister do? What will that young person do? Say, what's that to thee? I have set your own race before you. Walk the way you ought to walk. We're coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and I'm reading here from verse 18. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 18. But now, as God said, members, every one of them in the body, as it has pleased him. It's not the same role. It's not the same race. It's not the same privilege. It's not the same assignment. It's not the same occupation. It's not the same ministry. Yes, it's in the whole church. Yet, it's a part of a great commission. But it set you here. It set you there. It set her there. It says, but now, as God said, the members, every one of them in the body, as it has pleased him. Look at verse 28. And God has set some in the church. First, apostles, they have their own restaurant. Secondly, prophets, they have their own restaurant. And thirdly, teachers, they have their own restaurant. After that, miracles. Then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. And then he goes on, are they all apostles? The answer is no. He said, everyone. And so then we know what he has said for us, each of us. And he said us to get those things done. Each must run his own race. The race that is set before him. What kind of race? Number one, the race of a pilgrim. The race of a pilgrim. Here we are on a journey between here and heaven. And as a pilgrim going from earth to heaven, we have the race that is set for us as a pilgrim. And it tells us in 1 Peter chapter 2, reading here from verse 11. 1 Peter chapter 2, reading from verse 11. Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. Whatever the race, like a pilgrim, there's something to lay aside. There's something to push aside. There's something to separate from. As a pilgrim, you're running the race of a Christian. And as a Christian, you're following Christ. And anything that contradicts that life of Christ, you want to lay aside. We're soldiers of Christ. And he sent the race for a soldier. And he says, as a soldier, this is what to do. And as a soldier, there are things to lay aside. He gives us also the race of an evangelist. Do the work of an evangelist. And as he calls us to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, here is the evangelist. He has his race to run. As a minister, we have the race to run. That's why Paul the apostle said, I'm not beating the air. I'm not fighting a shadow boxing. I'm doing something real, and I'm going to have the mastery. And then he gives us the race as a set appointed servant of the Lord. And then he tells us, we lay aside, lay aside. If we are going to run successfully, thank God you are going to run successfully. You are going to be victorious. and you'll be triumphant in Jesus' name. Come back now to Hebrews chapter 12 verse 1. Wherefore seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. Did you see about those cloud of witnesses? All those people mentioned in chapter 11, they didn't contradict one another, and they didn't kind of conflict with one another. They were running in their own track, and these one did not come to the track of this one. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did not disturb Daniel, and Daniel did not disturb Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. There was no conflict between Moses and Joshua, and there was no conflict between David and Solomon. Each one had his own track and had his own race to run, and they concentrated on their race. That's what the Lord is telling us. We're compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, and then you take care of staying in your track, and you take care of staying on the race you are called to run, so that by the grace of God, leave him to run his race, he'll do well. I leave you to run your race, you will do marvelously well. And then he says, laying aside every weight. What's that? As we're running the race, and he says, we lay aside every weight. Let me show you an example. We're looking at 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17, and I'm reading from verse 38. 1 Samuel chapter 17 verse 38, it says, and Saul armed David with his armor, and he put an helmet of brass upon his head. Also he armed him with a coat of mail, and David girded his sword upon his armor, and he assayed, he tried, he endeavored to go, not even to run, he just endeavored to move and to walk, for he had not proved it. And David said unto Saul, I cannot go with these. This is the weight. I cannot run with this. My cunning cannot abide with this, for I have not proved them. And David, what did he do? He put them off him. He laid that aside. It wasn't seen. It was something Saul could carry, but it wasn't meant for David. And the thing became a weight on him, and so he laid it aside. He said, I know what I will do to run my own race. I know the power I need. I know the strength I need. And then he told them the Philistine, he said, you come to me with stave and sword, but I am spare, but I come to you in the name of the Lord. Do you remember the righteous runneth into that name of the Lord like a mighty power tower? And he said, look at verse 48 now. Look at verse 48 of that same chapter 17. And it says, and it came to pass when the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, that David hasted and... tell me out aloud, and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. If he had that weight on, could he have run like that? No, he couldn't have run like that. That's what the Lord is saying. Anything you put on, anything that comes on your life, anything that comes on your mind that weighs you down, that holds you down, that is so heavy, and then you are not active again, you are not alive, and you are not excited, you are not enthusiastic, and your faith is down, and you're only thinking of what you are carrying, it says lay that aside. And then when you lay that aside, you're free, and you'll be free to run the race. You will run in Jesus' name. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 12 and in verse 1, wherefore seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. And the sin which does so easily beset us. What is that? The sin which does so easily beset us. We're coming to Mark chapter 7. Mark chapter 7. We're reading here from verse 7 and reading from verse 9. reading from verse 7 and verse 9. It says, how be it in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. In verse 9, and he said unto them, full well ye reject the commandment of God, that ye may keep your own tradition. Underline that word, tradition, tradition. Oh, you might say, but that's not our problem. You think so? Here is, we're now in Acts of the Apostles chapter 10. And God called Peter and said, arise, take and eat. And he said, no, nothing like that ever entered my mouth. And the Lord was calling him to go to the house of Cornelius. And eventually, the Lord did it the second time. He said, no, not so, Lord. And you remember, that's a peculiar problem of Peter. When Jesus said, I'm going to go to the cross, not so, Lord. And this time now again, not so, Lord. And he said, I can't take that. And then it came the third time again. He was still thinking about that. And the people came from the house of Cornelius. And the Spirit of God said, Simon Peter, I have sent those people. Lay this tradition aside. This is the sin that so easily besets you, that will hinder you from getting to the Gentiles and preaching the word of God unto them. And eventually he went. When he came back in Acts of the Apostles chapter 11, all the other apostles gathered together and they said, what have you done? We heard that you have gone to the Gentiles and you ate with them, tradition, and that would have hindered them from reaching out and running the race that is set before them, when he said, you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be, we shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem. They did that well. In Samaria, they didn't do that well. Philip had to go there, and then in Judea to the uttermost part of the earth. Eventually, Galatians chapter 2, Peter now was summoning up courage. He was eating with the Gentiles, and Paul was there eating with the Gentiles. Here is great fellowship. And then the Jews from Jerusalem, they were coming, and very quickly Peter pulled back as if he was not part of that fellowship. And Paul the apostle said, hey, come on here, what are you doing? You've been eating with us now, and you saw these people, and then your tradition came back to you. Lay that aside. In your life, you may find, here is the thing the Lord has set before you. Here is the race he has set before you. And there are some traditions you brought from your past. There are some traditions, not in the New Testament, that you're still holding on to. I cannot do that. And I ask you for the chapter and the verse. And I ask you whether it is that by revelation of the grace of God. You say, no, I just know that I can't do that. You might have to lay that aside so that you will reach the people that God has called you to reach. You will reach the people. Tradition will not hinder you. The sin that so easily beset will not hinder you. And your own mindset will not hinder you in Jesus' name. We can say amen now. Amen. Now we're coming to point number two. Point number two now, looking unto Jesus until we receive the prize. Looking unto Jesus until we receive the prize. Here we are now. We're coming to Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm reading verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. It tells us here, looking unto Jesus. Look up here for a moment. At the time this was written, Jesus was not physically here. And because he had gone to heaven already, set at the right hand of majesty on high. And yet it says, looking unto Jesus, the invisible Christ, the one who has gone to heaven. And yet it says, with the eyes of your spirit, with the eyes of your inner man, with the eyes of your mind looking unto Jesus. Come to chapter 11 verse 27. Chapter 11 verse 27 of Hebrews. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king. Look at this. For he endured as seeing him who is invisible. He said the same thing that those Old Testament people that they had to do. They didn't see God in the physical, but then it says they endured and they were fearless and they were bold and they were courageous as seeing the invisible. He said the same thing. Christ has not gone to heaven and he appears invisible unto us, and yet he says looking unto Jesus who has gone into heaven. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Here we're reading from verse 18. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord. That is, we're gazing on the Lord. We know he has said, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there in their midst. We know he has said, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. And so we're looking at the invisible. And so we're seeing the invisible. And so we're gazing on the invisible. While we're praying, we know that he's there. We're praying for the sick, we're seeing the invisible right there, and he is the one going to heal them. And we're praying for a mountain to move, and we see Jesus Christ, we're looking on him, and we're looking at him going to remove that mountain. Like Moses saw the invisible, we see the invisible, we see Christ is there. We're claiming a promise, and we know that we're looking unto Jesus, that even though we cannot see with our physical eyes, we know he's there. Like tonight, I know he's there by your side. I said he's there by your side. And everywhere you go, every step you move, Jesus is always there. And he says, we are looking unto Jesus. In this place, he says, we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, we are changed into the same image. Hold on. When you're looking at Jesus, you're looking at him, it's deliverance. And you can, you know, there is what we call imagination. And imagination is very, very strong. Imagination. And do you understand that all the things you see today, there was a time they were not there. It came through imagination. For example, there were some people that sat on two brothers and they said, it must be possible that because of the traffic a hold up, it must be possible to have something that will be in the air that will overcome the power of gravity. Normally, anything you throw up will come down. But they said there must be something. They imagine that there will be something people can get into. It will get off ground, it will go in the air, it will overcome mountains and seas and everything. And lo and behold, they kept on experimenting, they kept on trying, they kept on trying, until now we have the aeroplane. There was a time when telephone was not even available. Imagination. Somebody made the imagination. It must be possible that we can talk to somebody in another place. And then they started connecting wire and wire. And then they saw that it's going to take a slow process for everybody to talk to everybody else if we're going to depend on wires. And somebody said it must be possible to make it wireless. And now we have the cell phone. All the things that have appeared today, computer, internet, whatever you are thinking about of the modern gadgets, it started with imagination. The same thing you can imagine as you pray, Christ is there. And this one is spiritual imagination. And this one is a real imagination. He said, I will be there, he is there. I said, he is there. And then you say, it must be possible to move this mountain if he can still do the same thing, because Jesus, yesterday, today, and forever, is still the same. That mountain will go. And when you have that spiritual, supernatural imagination, and you're looking at him, you are transformed from the image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 16. In verse 16 it says, for which cause we faint not. It says, though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. That is, in the physical, you might be getting weary, but your inner man is getting stronger. I said, your inner man is getting stronger. Look up at me here, you understand? Everything you do is by the strength of the inner man. Let's say, for example, your hands are alright, your feet are alright, your eyes are alright, everything about you in the physical alright, but you were strong, you wanted to carry a bucket of water, and somebody came to give you bad news. And the bad news is that somebody is gone, somebody is dead. And immediately your hands are still there, your feet are still there, your inner man becomes weak and you cannot carry that bucket of water anymore. Nothing wrong with you really, but that information that came into your spirit weakened the inner man. Turn it around. There are times when your hands are weak, you are getting older, and your feet are trembling, you are getting older, and it appears that physically you are kind of going down in the outward man, but you're feeding your inner man, you're strengthening your inner man. In the inner man, you are stronger than you were when you were younger. And it is not the outer man that is going to remove the mountain, it's your inner man that is going to remove the mountain. And I'm telling you, as you picture Jesus Christ and you are looking at Jesus Christ, even tonight you can remove that mountain. Even tonight you say, and it's your inner man talking, it's not the outward man, your hand can be down and you can even be sitting down. In that sitting position you'll manifest authority. Because whether you are standing or sitting, if you shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be cast into the sea, is the inner man talking. And you know, the one you are talking to is also invisible, the evil spirit and the evil power, and is deep talking unto deep, that thing will vanish away. Look at verse 17. It says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Look at verse 18. While we look not at things which are seen. While we look not at things which are seen. Look up here. Let's say, for example, there is a window. And then there is no blind. And you look outside the window, you look at something there that you don't really appreciate. You can draw the blind. And when you put down the blind, then that thing is still there, but you can't see it. Am I right? You can do that spiritually too. When your mind is looking at something, your mind is concentrating on something, your mind is analyzing something, and the thing you are looking at in your mind, and the thing you are meditating off in your mind, is weakening you. Draw the blind and shut it off, and then turn around and begin to look at Jesus. I begin to look at heaven. I begin to look at the promises. I begin to look at the possibilities we have in the Spirit of God. Everything around you will change. Look at verse 18. Why we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. We're looking at the things which are not seen. It says, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. We're coming to Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm reading from verse 2. Hebrews chapter 12, and we're looking at verse 2. It tells us here in verse 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Is the author of our faith. Is the origin of our faith. Is the beginning of our faith. Is the generator of our faith. Is the producer of our faith. You see, if it is faith by yourself, if it is faith in yourself, If it is faith you try to pump up by yourself, that's self-confidence, that's self-righteousness. Nothing amounts to nothing. But if it's a gift that the Lord has given you, that you just know that Jesus is my Savior, and that faith is not of you, it is God himself that gave that to you. And the same thing, the faith by which you live, he has planted it there. And because that faith is coming from God himself, coming from Christ himself, he is the author, he is the producer, he is the originator of our faith. And not only that, is the finisher of our faith. That's what finisher means, is the perfecter. That means is the one that matures that faith, and is the one that refines that faith, is the refiner of our faith. And that faith will always work. I said that faith will always work. It's coming from him. It's coming from him. It must work because he is the originator. He is the author. And he is the finisher. He is the refiner. We're looking at Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2. I'm reading here from verse 20. In Galatians chapter 2 verse 20. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Look at this, look at this. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by, tell me somebody there. I live by, tell me out aloud. I live by the faith of the Son of God. The very faith of the Son of God. The very faith of the Son of God. I live by the faith of the Son of God. I pray by the faith of the Son of God. I believe by the faith of the Son of God. I act by the faith of the Son of God. I move by the faith of the Son of God. I live by the faith of the Son of God. When you understand that that faith is not just your own private faith, that Jesus is the author of that faith, is the giver of that faith, is the originator of that faith, and is the refiner, is the finisher, is the perfecter of that faith, your prayer will be answered. Your life will be perfect, and your life will be straightforward in Jesus' name. It says, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. With that kind of faith, with you, all things are possible. Look at Mark chapter 9. Mark chapter 9. Reading from verse 23. In Mark chapter 9, verse 23. Look at what is saying here. It said, Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. Verse 24, and straightway the father of the child cried out and said, with tears, Lord, I believe. But the way I believe is not enough. Help thou mine unbelief. Bring your faith and put it into me. And bring your faith and let it act on my behalf. And Jesus' faith acted on his behalf, and his son was set free. And Jesus' faith will act on your behalf, and your life is set free. Look at this in Mark chapter 11. I'm reading from verse 22. Mark 11 verse 22. Jesus answering said unto them, have faith in God. In the original, have the faith of God, because he is the author, he is the finisher, he is the originator, and he is the refiner, he is the source, and he is the perfecter of your faith. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart. I'm reading this for somebody over there, and shall not doubt in his heart. I'm not a doubter. I said I'm not a doubter. I am a believer. But shall believe that those things which he says shall come to pass, he shall have. He shall have. Tonight he shall have. At home he shall have. in the local church, he shall have whatsoever he says. Give me a good amen. We'll come back to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, but still looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross. We just learned about that yesterday. Endured the cross. He did that for you. He did that for me. And then despising the shame, and he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. But you know what we're being taught here? We're told that Jesus Christ is a perfect example. And because he's a perfect example, he endured the cross. How could he endure the cross? Because of the joy that was set before him. How do we endure any little challenge, any little problem, the reproach, the persecution, the cross, or whatever it is, by looking at what is set before us? Because we know we're going to reign with Christ. I said we're going to reign with Christ. When you think about what we go through here on earth, let's say for example, you go through something, you know, somebody is sick, you're not sick every day. Let's say for example, some 10 years ago, you were sick for 1 week. Some 7 years ago, you were sick for another 1 week. Oh yes, in the primary school, you were sick for about 2-3 weeks. When you bring everything together, if they were to follow in succession, they're not up to 52 weeks of your life. That is, you have suffered, you have suffered, you have suffered. I remember this, I remember this, I remember that. I bring everything together. As you bring everything together, it is not up to 1 year of your life. Let's say even we bring everything together, it's up to 1 year of your life that you have suffered. You see, as I put everything together, since the time I was born, I remember my time in the hospital. I remember my time on the sick bed. I remember it was like, you know, the world was coming to an end. I put everything together, 1 year. But you know, when you get to heaven, 1,000 years, you have just started. 2,000 years, you're still there. 10,000 years, you're still there. 100,000 years, you're still there. 1,000,000 years, you're still there. Remember, only 1 year, when you put everything together here, in comparison with 1,000,000 years you're over there, that 1 year of suffering is nothing. I said it's nothing. And so as you look forward and you see what you are going to have, and you set your eyes and you set your mind on the joy that is before you, all the things that may be happening now, all the things that might have happened, they amount to nothing. Somebody give me the word nothing. Tell me it's a big zero. It's infinitesimal. It's negligible. And it is nothing. You'll not worry about nothing anymore in Jesus' name. I said you'll not worry about nothing in Jesus' name. Colossians chapter 3, Colossians chapter 3. I'm reading from verse 1. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections. That's what you're looking at. 1,000 years coming, 1,000,000 years coming, 10,000,000,000 years coming, 1,000,000,000,000 years coming, the glory that shall come, that's what you are looking at. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. No amen. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then you, who is he, who is that? I'll see you, and I'll see the glory of God upon your life in Jesus' name. Will appear with him in glory. Therefore, that's why whatever is happening now is so negligible, we shouldn't even talk of them. We should be thinking of the joy that is set before us, of the glory that is set before us. Point number 3 now is learning of Jesus in order to reach the peak. learning of Jesus in order to reach the peak. We're coming to Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm reading from verse 3. It says, "For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself." Number one, in this section, our consideration of Jesus. When anything happens to you, consider him. When you are disappointed by somebody you trusted, consider him. You know how Judas has called disappointed him? And when it appears there is thorn on the road you're taking, consider him. He had a crown of thorns. And when it appears you are hungry, consider him. There was a time he was hungry, he was sitting by the well. And when it appears people tell lies against you, they contradicted themselves concerning Jesus, consider him. Number one, our consideration of Jesus. Look at Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Hebrews chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider, consider, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Jesus Christ. Number 2, the contradiction of the Jews. The contradiction of the Jews. Look at this, verse 3. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself. Against himself. You saw their contradiction. On the one hand, they'll say, "We're going to make him a king." And Jesus went away from them. And now again, they said, "He is making himself the king of the Jews." That's contradiction. You said you wanted to make him a king, and then he left. And when you saw him, you said, "When did you come here?" And then one time he multiplied the bread and he said, "This is wonderful." And then they removed all the fragments and they collected 12 baskets. And then they said, "Now you tell us you want to be our Lord. Where is the miracle? Where is the food you are going to give us?" Contradiction of sinners. And when he was to be crucified and Pilate said, "What has he done?" They said, "Don't worry about that. Let his blood be upon us." And now when the apostles were preaching, they said, "Come on here. You are accusing us and you want to bring the blood of this man upon us." Those people, they contradicted themselves. And when people talk to you, and when people act to you, on the one hand, it looks like they are appreciating you. On the other hand, it looks like they are belittling you. The contradiction of sinners. Don't let that bother you. They did it to Jesus. If they do it to you, that just shows that they identify you with Christ. Thank God you suffer as a Christian. And great will be your reward in Jesus' name. Number 3 now, the character of the justified. The character of the justified. Look at that verse 3. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest he be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not resisted blood, ye have not resisted unto blood, striving against sin. That's what we are to do. We are to resist sin. Number one, resist sin. It will come in the form of temptation. It will come in the form of enticement. It will come in terms of a sweetened poison. You resist it, you will overcome. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. Number two, refuse to sin. Refuse to sin. Just say no. You will not do it. I said you will not do it. Look at Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. Reading from verse 24. By faith Moses, when he was called, when he was come to years, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Just say no. They offered. They gave. They cajoled. They tried to, you know, help him to see the value of this. He said no. He refused to sin. Number 3, you renounce sin totally, completely, with the whole heart. You renounce and say, no, that will not be. I've come out of that. I will not go back again. I say good night. I will not say good evening again. It's gone, and it's gone forever. I said, for you, it's gone, and it's gone forever. You renounce it. Second Corinthians chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 2. Second Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2. But I've renounced the hidden things of dishonesty. I've renounced it. It's like a covenant between me and the Almighty God. I've opened my mouth to the Lord, and I cannot go back. You renounce the sin. Number four, you refrain from sinful speech. Anything that will come out of your mouth, examine, think before you speak. And as you think, if it is going to be slander, if it is going to be a lie, if it's going to be deception, if it's going to be to cover up something, you refrain from sinful speech. It says in 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 10. 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 10. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips from speaking guile. Number five, you remove sinners from his service. You're a minister, you're a pastor, you're an overseer, and you see that there is somebody who is living in sin, and he doesn't ever plan, at least from his action, at least from his outlook, to get rid of that sin. Is defending that sin, is protecting that sin, and that sin will spread to other people. Remove sinners from the service of the Lord. Acts chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 22. Acts chapter 13, verse 22. And when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David. You always find a replacement when somebody remains in sin, adamant in sin, and he wants to be leading other people into sin. You want to remove such a person because God has 100,000 other people to replace him or her. I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. You will not be the sinner to be removed. I said you will not be the sinner to be removed. Number one, resist sin. Number two, refuse to sin. Number three, renounce sin. Number four, refrain from sinful speech. Number five, remove sinners from his service. Number six, reverse the statutes of sin. Reverse the statutes of sin. Esther chapter 8. I'm reading from verse 5. Esther chapter 8, verse 5. And said, if it please the king, and if I have found favor in his sight, and the thing seem right before the king, and I be pleasing in his eyes, let it be written to reverse. Let it be written to reverse the letters devised by Haman, the son of Amadasa, the Agagite, which he wrote to destroy the Jews which are in all the king's provinces. You know the story. Haman had written something by the seal of the king that all the Jews shall be wiped out, exterminated. Now Esther came and said, O king, if I please you, if my life pleases you, then Let it be written that will reverse the law and the statutes of sin that a man had put down. And I pray that in your own life, in your own family, and in your own ministry, all the statutes of sin that will make sin spread in our local church or in any church, I pray that God will use you. You will reverse them in Jesus' name. Number seven now is to reject the source of sin. You see, Jeroboam became the source of sin. And then God said, this is Jeroboam that made Israel to sin. And eventually he was rejected and he was exterminated. I pray that any source of sin in your own community, you receive that sin unto blood, and you will reject every source of sin or sinfulness in Jesus' name. Did I hear any amen on that side? Second Kings chapter 1 Kings chapter 14. In 1 Kings chapter 14, here we're reading from verse 16. 1 Kings chapter 14, and we're reading from verse 16. 1 Kings chapter 14 verse 16, it says, and he shall give Israel up because of the sins of Jeroboam, who did sin, and what? Who made Israel to sin. You'll not be hiding somebody in the local church, in the district church, that is only there making people to sin, making people to forget the standard of holiness in the word of God, and leading people astray. You remember Jesus. I remember Jesus. I said I remember Jesus. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 8. 2 Timothy chapter 2, reading from verse 7. Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. All that we have learned today, the Lord give you understanding. All that we have taught today, the Lord give you understanding. And then you become stronger, higher, and you reach farther in your life in Jesus' name. Verse 8, remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel. And tonight, you look unto Jesus. You learn of Jesus. And you leave all anything that will conflict with your calling in the ministry. You leave all for Jesus. And tonight, a new life has begun. A new power in your life. A new authority in your life. And you know, he set the race before you. Lay aside everything that will hinder your progress, and then run the race with perseverance and patience. And every day as you look unto Jesus, great will be your victory, will be your triumph, and will be your success, will be your progress in the ministry in Jesus' name. Live all for Jesus, learn of Jesus, and look unto Jesus. Your victory will multiply. Let's rise up and pray to the Lord right now. Let's seriously, wholeheartedly, with faith, with passion, with fervency, take all this to the Lord in prayer.